You're next in line for the official Holiday World Podcast.
Welcome to Holiday World in Splash and Safari.
Dropping in from Santa Claus, Indiana.
Riders will experience swift acceleration, high-speed turns, and sudden stops.
With park president and CEO, Matt Eckert.
He's incredible.
Fourth-generation owners, Lauren Crosby.
Why don't we stick a performance venue in this space?
And director of communications, Leah Cook.
This is how we do it here.
Now stow your loose articles, buckle up.
And please keep your hands and legs inside the car at all times.
And we're back. Welcome back to season two of the official Holiday World podcast. This is season two, episode 20. The one with, I didn't even finish it. This guy's... Guys, I just need to tell you that like while I was in the office earlier, no one saw it, thank goodness. But like, I'm wearing like tennis shoes. I'm in my comfy clothes because it's podcast day. I like go to walk into my office and I just like misjudged and walked into my office door. And like I had the tennis shoes on. It made the squeaky sound like I was like on a basketball court.
Like cartoony. And I,
half fell. And like I could see, like I could hear people like stop
that?
Conversations. And I just like ran into my office real fast and was like, so I'm just stumbling into today.
Nailed it.
No judge for Hollywood Nights. Who can say much?
It's been a long week. I am calling this episode the one with the trained knights. That would be me and Sabrina. We'll get into that a little bit later. But I wanted to highlight all of our special guests because Matt Eckert and Lauren are always absent because I ask them at the last minute and somehow they're never available. I don't know why that happens. So we've got our semi-regulars now. I don't even know if Lauren knows this podcast is happening at this point. She's packing. Our family's leaving for vacation tomorrow. She's packing. She's got two little ones to pack for. She had a bat in the house. It's not the day for her.
We should talk about the bats.
I want a whole bat episode now. Mm-hmm. We've got a whole thing. We've got a lot of material, but you know.
The month of the bats.
I've had a bat in my house. Mom's had a bat in her house. Lauren had a bat in her house today. We've got a lot of bat conversation that we
Halloween came early.
It's apparently bat season.
I just love how we're a couple of minutes in and we already have a big glitter squirrel that we're already talking about.
Yeah.
Did you say glitter squirrel? It's a thing in the attractions office.
Interesting.
Like, we don't just have squirrels and we don't just have glitter. We have glitter squirrels.
Gotcha.
Like, so yeah. Like, instead of
like on up where, you know, they're like,
that's squirrel. Exactly it.
Okay.
It's
right.
Very shiny.
It's just very shiny and distracting.
And it helps you guys roll back in. Like, you're like, oh, wait, we got off. Okay, we're good now.
It really doesn't, though.
It works for like 5 minutes.
Sock, everybody.
Until the next glitter squirrel.
Well, we've been warming up for a while because Matt was around a little late today.
Yep.
Because I told Matt the wrong time because, again,
I thought it was one.
Really stumbling into this podcast episode. Guys, I'm in vacation mode already. Yeah. Please forgive me. Anyway, our semi regular guests joining us today are Matt B., Vice President of Operations, and Sabrina from Communications. Welcome, guys. And we have the entire full-time attractions team joining us today. I can't talk either
the
today,
attractions
guys.
Dream attraction team.
Yeah.
There you go.
Yes. Yeah. That would be Lori, Alan, and Adam. Good luck separating Alan and Adam.
I flip flop them all the time. They just give me this dirty look like I'm used to.
I was going
to
say, we've already like mixed up the names like twice. So, you know.
It's been a thing since 2012.
Yeah,
so.
Listen. You change two letters, you have the other person's name. It's done.
We respond to either one.
But all three of us only have four letters in our name, so it's like we're all short and compact.
Yes. So to distinguish, I think I'm going to go, Alan, we're going to kick off with you. Okay. With tell us about how you came to Holiday World and tell us about, you know, the icebreaker question. If you could build an attraction or section, what would it be and why?
Okay. I started after my freshman year in college as a ride operator in 2011 and just kind of worked my way up. Yeah. I remember that we worked Voyage quite a lot together.
Yes, we did.
We had a good time.
We'll never forget the disappointment in your face one day when I almost lazy fingered on the back dispatch. I thought Alan was honestly going to come back on the platform and smack me.
I wouldn't put it past him.
We had a good pace going on the voyage, and I just like had like put my finger on the button to dispatch. Now it's not a thing. You just got to stand on a spot. That's much more my speed. But yeah, like, I hit the button and like let off because I was like, we're done. And was like, nope, I got to hold my finger there for the entire dispatch. We'll never forget that.
No, we won't. Hey, anyway, it happens. It happens.
Where were you when I interrupted your story?
I don't remember. Yeah, so it started in 2011. I just kind of worked my way up and joined the full-time team in October of 2017 as the Holiday World Attractions Manager.
So, and what would you build if you could build an attraction or section to the park?
See, I have always wanted to have a New Year's Eve section.
Ooh, nice.
Me too. With a Chinese restaurant and like a drop tower. A
little Chinese New Year section in that.
Even like an observatory type thing.
Yes.
I think that would be kind of, that would fit really well.
You know what? When I first saw Polar Coasters, those like really tall towers with that, I saw a drop tower themed thing there, like a New Year's ball drop. Words are hard. Anyway, but yeah,
I don't like polar coasters, but you know,
I've never ridden one.
I like the drop tower idea.
I'm not as fancy as you because I guess I haven't ridden one.
Has there actually been a polar coaster built? It's like one of those things. Like you'll randomly get somebody that says, "I'm going to build this company's going to build a massive theme park in the U.S." And then it never materializes. How many of these polar coasters have first 500-foot coaster has been being built for the last like 6 or 7 years and it still hasn't broken ground?
We're starting off strong with the shade today.
Listen, progress is progress, even if it's very slow progress.
There will never be another successful regional park built in the United States. The markets are mature. You won't see it.
Dang. Wow, you're really coming in with hot with this.
The strong projections.
The last one was at Myrtle Beach, right?
I don't know.
Yeah. It was.
Sure, you tell me.
It was
you're the pro here.
What, Hard Rock Park? And it only lasted a year or two.
Steven is playing charades from the sound booth. I love this so much now that we can actually see. Can we always record? It's weird that we're recording in a church sanctuary right now, but can we always record here? I love seeing the actual sound guys. Normally they're downstairs from us. This is great. I do request a puppet show by the next episode, so get ready. Get some socks out. Anyway, Matt, what
preferably
were you saying?
Clean socks.
No, I got my polar coaster rant out of the way.
I feel like those have to be just like trims all the way, right?
It looks
like
ridiculous.
It's gotta be like all trims.
It's not a 500-foot coaster. I mean, it's coaster track attached to a tower.
Yeah.
It's like, I don't know. It doesn't make any sense. I think it's a gimmick, and it'll never be around. And even once they build it, no one will like it. If they ever build it.
Tell us how you really feel.
I just had an idea for your Chinese New Year. What about a Chinese New Year-themed carousel?
All the different
animals on it.
I think that'd our like cool. running carousel count of like carousels we want to build is getting into like the tens.
We're
going
to have one in each section.
More carousels than any other park in the world.
Let's That's going to be our claim to fame now.
Who cares about being the water coaster capital of the world?
Yeah. The carousel capital of the world. Yeah. I like that.
Ooh, I like it. All right, Lori, let's go with you next. Same question. Tell us, refresh us on your history because you've been here before. But
oh, yeah. I kind of like Alan started here after my freshman year of college. It was actually our IT director that got me to come over here. So yeah, you can blame Casey.
Casey.
That's why I'm here. but my first year was 2007.
Nice.
And I started as a ride operator. And we like to joke that the best ones come from Thanksgiving because that's where Alan started.
Absolutely.
Too.
Listen.
100% agree.
Can I count as Thanksgiving? If
yes.
It was first trained in the kids' rides.
I think it counts as your first year. We'll count it.
Yes.
I like it.
I support it.
Fearless leader over here of the podcast.
Oh, yes.
Maybe I'm not a great thing feather to add to the cap of the Thanksgiving stuff. Maybe we should not count that. I was kids' rides. It's fine.
Oh. And then 2011, which was the year that Alan started, was the year that I went full-time in rides. Ooh. Then switched to water park manager in 2017 at the end of the season. And then end of 2018, took the director role. So I've worn a couple of different hats, and it's been a fun adventure.
All right. And what would you add?
Well, I originally said I would add the New Year's Eve portion, but I'm not a big fan of, you know, saying, well, he took my answer.
Yeah.
So I invented a new one on the fly here.
Ooh, I love it.
Wing it.
Yes.
Yeah. No, I also
Wing
mentioned.
Wing coaster?
We've got one. No, I had a conversation with our formal director, Eric Rentz, and together we kind of came up with like this dream coaster.
Ooh, is it his RMC legend?
No.
Okay, good.
No.
It's better.
It's wood. Okay. No, we came up with kind of a fun family concept coaster with a runaway sleigh and mischievous elves and just kind of a storyline.
Yeah, that's cool.
Yeah, something like that.
All right, Adam, your turn.
Best for last, I guess.
Oh, jeez.
Here we go.
There's the door if you're...
head just grew.
I didn't have to say it.
So I started at Holiday World when I was 16 as a ride operator in 2012. Our seasonal manager, Chuck Bradley, is the one who convinced me to work there.
Nice.
And I've been annoying Alan since. So
accurate statement.
I worked my way up in rides, and then I joined the full-time attractions team in January of 2019 as the Splash and Safari attractions manager.
Woo.
So it was a nice. It was a fun transition.
All right. And now the icebreaker question.
Don't say polar coaster.
Just because you said that.
I never said I was going to build it. I just thought it would be on theme.
So
okay.
I don't know specifically about a section, but I've been saying for years that I would love to get an S&S swing.
Screaming swing?
Yeah. I love those. And then I think it was a couple of weeks ago I said I would call it Let Freedom Swing, and Alan and Lori kind of rolled their eyes.
I love that. That's beautiful.
The worst.
It's almost as bad as the Jingle Bell Rock one.
Oh, what? Yeah.
I said that
I
we should
like that one, though.
We should get a rock and tug, put it in the Kitty Ranch and call it Jingle Bell Rock.
Oh, no.
Yeah, I remember that was said after that's my cool. Let Freedom Swing, and I was annoyed because that one was like, oh, yeah, that's fine. It's the same ballpark of a name.
You're just mad they like my idea better.
And this is one of the attractions offices every day.
Never a dull moment.
No. So,
this has been fun. I've asked you guys here, though, so we can do kind of a recap of Hollywood Nights. And also, you know, after we take a break, after we talk about Hollywood Nights, I want you guys to talk about Sabrina and I getting trained on the voyage. We are a special crew to train. But first, let's start with Hollywood Nights. Guys, it's only been 1 week. I don't know why, but it feels like it's like years ago now that Hollywood Nights happened.
That's been the
consensus. And yet I'm still sleep deprived.
Yeah.
Each day feels like a week.
Yes, that is accurate.
2020, am I right? Yeah. So yeah, attractions. Tell me about like what you guys do during Hollywood Nights aside from, you know, running ERT.
Well,
I'm looking at Adam because I know Adam will always find an answer for anything.
You're not wrong. I mean, it's a lot of chaotic fun before the ERT begins. And we have, you know, typically our really good operators out on the slides, on the rides, and it's just chaos getting everything ready to go.
It's a tight turnaround. It's a
controlled chaos.
Yeah. Every year it's like chaos, chaos, chaos. This year things started going so smooth on Friday, and then Holiday World ERT started, and it kind of went. What happened?
What was that?
She was texting me as it was happening. See, it was different this year because normally, and I didn't fully realize this until Lori pointed it out to me, but normally the park is still operational when Hollywood Nights starts, and we started out on Friday this year, and we're only open on Saturdays and Sundays right now. So that kind of threw, I don't want to say it threw a wrench into some of the plans, but it just
threw off the groove.
Caught everybody off guard a couple times, I think.
Yeah, threw up my groove, man.
All right, Cusco. Come on.
Yeah. Yeah, Saturday I felt like we were getting into the groove of things. But yeah, I mean, you guys have, I don't think all of the enthusiasts appreciate that, you know, we've got, you know, on Saturday of Hollywood Nights this year still, we've got all these ride operators that, you know, have probably worked at least half the day, if not the full day. We got to feed them really fast and get them right back out to their coasters. And I know that's an insane process for you guys. So I just want to say we appreciate it so much.
You got a lot of compliments
on
the efficiency of the rides too.
Yeah.
I heard a lot of people talking about it.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think we kind of derive energy from all the attendees too.
Oh yes.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
You know, it's kind of impossible to go slow when you have that much energy in your station.
Yeah. Well, I think it was kind of fun to see, you know, while I was up on the platform, even though, you know, because in my mind I was like, well, maybe the energy is just going to be gone by the time, you know, you pull all those people out of the station with social distancing and everything. But the energy, I feel like, was 10 times more just from a few people.
They were even more excited by the time they got into the station because they were waiting and they just kept seeing it go go. And then they were like, oh, it's my time. Because Voyage was running like none other. So. Yes.
Well, and that's, I will never forget the terrifying task of having to go in front of all of the enthusiasts first thing at Hollywood Nights this year and saying, we might have to turn the trims on. It depends on... But I did get to go out there and also tell them that the Voyage was hauling with empty trains. So,
it was.
We've got time cut off, and we were getting real close to it, just running empty trains as we were, Sabrina and I were finishing up our training since a storm came through while we were getting trained the day before. Anyway, details that we'll share later. But yeah, I mean, it's so exciting to be at Hollywood Nights, and I think everyone was just so appreciative because it's just such a crazy year. It felt like it was going to be impossible.
Well, we plan on the energy that comes from the enthusiasts anyway. I know I took some time to ask Alan, who's going to be at Legend Main Console this year? I got to show them the hoof trick.
So if you don't know, if you haven't been to Hollywood Nights or if you don't know, Adam does a thing. I feel like you need to do it on the microphone right now.
Oh, I can totally do it on the mic. I think.
You might have to stand up.
Maybe. Okay.
There you go.
He's gonna demonstrate.
So...
this was Adam's trick. He claims this as his signature here.
Oh, that's nice.
He does that, and I mean, it always matches the theme of the legend, but this year it was especially appropriate because the theme was Monty Python, the Holy Grail.
Oh, yeah. I had some of my Splash and Safari attractions management team asking if they could take coconuts around with them and just move around. And
there was one of the enthusiasts.
Yeah.
I think it was the gentleman that donated all the money.
Different
not
one,
money, but there was
that dressed in like character and had the coconuts around his head,
crown on.
Different one, but he was so into it. And I loved that so much. Both of them had like, we need like spirit awards for Hollywood Nights.
Yes. That's a good idea.
We should totally bring that around next year because I'm telling you, it's so fun to see everyone get so into it. And it's just, I want a way to like reward the people who really come in and come full bore.
Yeah. And it was just the crazy, like fun things. Like there was a group with dog masks and there was the one, did you see the one girl that had the light up mask?
Yeah. That was so cool.
That was awesome.
Neat. That was
neat. Like, I want one.
Wait. I know. How do I get one of those?
There was a light up mask.
What did I see?
Yes.
What? $28 on Amazon.
$28. Ooh, so, never mind.
That was the one with Prime. So almost worth it. The other one would have been here.
I'm a big $20. Fan of these that come from the park.
Yeah. What are you holding?
I'm holding.
It's, Matt forgot that we have an audience that listens to this after we record. Yeah,
it's just a disposable medical grade.
Yeah.
So that's what we give to all the staff. The staff has, you know, the custom Holiday World Hollow Smile mask, but they also have the option of picking up a fresh disposable mask before their shift.
Yeah.
I go to the disposable mask route. Yeah. So
I've got, I think, enough masks now to make it through a solid 2 weeks without having to launder them. that's where I went is after a certain point I went, I can't rewear these masks. So I gotta, and I can't be relied upon to do laundry in a consistent way. So here we are. Okay. I have a note here that I have to ask you guys, what is 2 against 1?
It's all
they were talking
fault,
right
Lori.
Before this kicked off, I just heard 2 against 1, and I'm like, "What?"
I started when it worked in my favor the first time, and we were all kind of debating about something, and I don't remember who had the same opinion as me, and I was like, 2 against 1, 2 wins, and ever since it's been working against me.
So this is just like a thing now. When you guys get into a debate, you go 2 against 1, and that's
just
the winner.
Thing. Yeah,
that determines
like
the winner.
Doesn't like seriously matter about something. Yeah. We'll just go, okay, 2 against 1.
That's amazing. I love it. Okay. So we're going to take a short break. I do want to make sure before, you know, we head out into this break, I want to make sure that we mention if someone doesn't know what Hollywood Nights is, we failed to explain it from the get-go, but this podcast has basically been entirely Hollywood Nights for the last like several weeks. Guys, I don't know how to convey this to you, but this is the only exciting thing that has happened.
It's a win, and we're going to claim it.
It's a win, and we're going to claim it. I do just want to thank everyone who came for Hollywood Nights this year. You know, we know that you guys were great about wearing masks, and we saw a lot of good social distancing. You guys really were the example, especially when the park was operating. It was great to see all those red lanyards showing the rest of the general public how to do it. So thank you to everyone who did that. And thank you to everyone who corrected once we reminded them to keep following that. Thanks so much for being flexible with us because, you know, this was the first time we've ever opened the park, especially for you. And we definitely had some learning curve on a lot of this. And also thank you for being flexible when we smashed the schedule on our food and beverage department and didn't think that one through all the way. That was, we just completely didn't think about the fact that normally that food time starts about an hour earlier before the park closes. And then we have the hour.
The food team recovered quickly.
Oh, they were amazing. Yeah. The food and beverage team was incredible.
They opened up another lane, and I think everyone got through pretty quick.
Yeah.
Not just that, but it was so delicious.
It was really good. Yeah.
They do know how to provide some really good food.
Monte Cristos.
Oh, those Monte Cristos. I'm fine. what were we talking about? But, you know, I just hope you guys could all see how hard our attractions team was working and how hard our food and beverage team was working, because we were so happy to have you guys, and we hope it showed. So we're going to take a quick break, and we'll be back soon with the saga of training Sabrina and Leah.
I want to tell you about Cheetah Chase, the new ride at Holiday World in Splash and Safari. It's the world's first launched water coaster, which means you get up to full speed first thing, which was pretty much impossible in a water coaster until now. It goes really fast with lots of sudden turns. It kind of sneaks up on you with a launch, which is why I'm talking so fast. You even race side by side against another boat, so you should definitely get to HolidayWorld.com for tickets today, especially since that's the only place to buy them this summer. Let's see, anything else about Cheetah Chase? No, I don't think so. Oh, maybe just this one thought.
Have an idea for next year's Hollywood Nights? Great! We don't. If you don't contribute, I'll be forced to host Eat, Pray, Love, and I've never seen the movie Eat, Pray, Love, but you can bet it won't be great. If you have an idea, send Holiday World a direct message, post on the Hollywood Nights Facebook group, or reach out using the usual podcast avenues at the end of the episode. We'd love to hear your thoughts. Your prize will be the satisfaction of having developed the movie theme, and we'll try to give you some recognition as well. Let's dive into the other part of Hollywood Nights. One thing that we did this year was host an all-ladies voyage ride. I want to start by telling the tale of I was on Twitter one day and saw this thing about, like, if anyone's interested in this event, and someone had tagged us, and I was like, what event at Hollywood Nights? Like, what's going on, guys? Dug deeper. You know, occasionally someone tries to, like, hand out something or solicit business at Hollywood Nights, so we try to shut that down. And then I dug deeper and found out that it was this, it was Gabby who had this great idea for an all-ladies voyage ride. So basically, there's not a lot of women in the coaster community, or they're not very connected. So the thought was just to kind of unify them and bring them all together. I immediately loved this idea and started texting with Lori immediately. Yeah. We had the idea to show some support and provide an all-female crew.
Yeah, and it was fun.
It was so fun. It was great. And they got a ton of women involved, and it was just really great to see. But part of this was Sabrina and I requested that we wanted to be a part of the all-female crew to run this thing, which brings in the entire attractions team. So, you know, I want to start by saying I was like a problem child from the get-go on this thing. Like, Microsoft had a delay when I was doing my IROC training.
Right.
Lori's like texting me like the day we're going to start training, and we can't find my training anywhere.
Surely she did it.
I was like, I can tell you my score. I did fine.
I took a screenshot.
I was like, wait, is the score suddenly not acceptable? Did they change the rules? I'll go back and retake it. I did go back and retake it.
Yeah.
You did?
Only missed one question that time. Bam. So that's my new score, for the record.
You beat me.
58 out of 59. Yep. That's my score.
What did I say I got? I think I got 56 out of 59.
Oh, my first time I got 55.
I was very deliberate when I took the test because I was, and the ones that I missed, I felt like,
yeah,
there were some
tricky,
right.
Yeah, there were some tricky ones in there. Yeah. But yeah, they had a lot of answers that are like, could be right, but this one's more right. Or yeah. Like, yeah. Yep.
Yep. It make you think.
Well, yeah. It takes like two and a half hours to take?
It took me a long time.
About 2 hours.
Yeah. Well, I just remember it was like 2 hours till we were supposed to train, and Leah's like, I've got to retake it.
I kept getting interrupted. People kept coming into my office.
Right.
I'm taking my IRT training.
I was at least glad that wasn't like a test all at the end, which, by the way, I guess we should explain that before any ride operator comes to our park, they go through this IRT training. Lori, do you want to explain what that is?
Sure. At our park, we use a third party called IRT, which is International Ride Training, and they have a ride operator certification program called IROC, which is for International Ride Operator Certification. And actually, there was a couple podcasts back that we had Cindy on talking about it. Mm-hmm. So there's that if anybody wants more information on that one. But whenever we started having the stay-at-home orders and things like that, they jumped in and really provided a ton of support to all the parks that use them. And they actually provided us with our IROC training, which we would typically do at the park. Mm-hmm. So we were able to move all of that online.
It's amazing.
Yeah, and it helps streamline a lot of things. And, you know, carrying it on into the season was very nice.
Let's get Patty on the podcast at some point.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. That'd be so much fun. Would be great.
Patty is such a character. Yes. But anyway, you know, the training is, I love it because it means that all of the parks that do this kind of have a standardized spot from which we start. And so, you know, the hand signals might be slightly different, but we all are speaking the same language. We all know kind of what the deal is with a ride, and it tells you what a safe zone is and things like that. So,
you know, I think we should give a shout out to the Attractions Dream Team since they're here.
Sure.
They did particularly well on our IRT audits because that's the other point we audited.
Woo.
So what did we receive on our audits this year?
We received a high pass. Woo. And several of the rides on those high passes have gotten perfect scores. So we're super proud of those crews.
We got a great team. That's and a great frontline team out there that's putting into practice what they're learning in the classroom. So it's really, really great.
Even though the title says ride operator certification, it's also in our water park.
I was about to interject with that.
Yeah, well, you talk about that a little bit.
We started integrating some of these practices into the water park operation with our slide attendants. But this year was the first formal year that they were audited as well.
Ooh.
And they did very well. Cheetah Chase, which was our brand new attraction this year, received a perfect score from our slide attendants.
Yeah.
So that was especially a proud moment for my team because they did great.
That's
they
amazing.
Rocked it.
Yep.
Just for you, Adam.
Thank you. Thank you.
I love it. Okay. So let's see. We've made it to training now. So bless Sabrina's heart. Alan had the task of training two people, one of which was me, who, like, I've operated a ride before, but, like, I had all of the questions because I was, you know, last time I operated a ride was probably 2013, maybe for, like, a day. And, or maybe it was 2012 for, like, a day. Anyway, it's been a while. And so I was like, wait, is this still a thing? And so Alan's answering all of these questions coming from me, and Sabrina has never operated a ride before. And,
it brought back that feeling in driver's ed whenever the teacher looked at you and they're like, this is a dangerous weapon. And like, I just like was terrified of everything. Like, I didn't really know where to stand. I didn't really know like where I was like,
what to do with your hands.
Even though as I'm moving my hands, like,
oh my gosh, if we compare this to driver's ed, I'm like that country kid that's been driving a car since I was like 10.
Yes.
Like, I'm like that kid. I feel like that was the thing in driver's ed for me, at least. There were all these like farmer kids and things like that. They're like, yep, my grandpa handed me the keys to the truck when I was six. And I'm like, what?
See, I was that kid in driver's ed. I was like,
I've never sat behind the wheel of a car. What?
We were on like Cloverleaf in Evansville, and like I was accelerating to the turn. Yeah. And I look over, and my driver's ed teacher's got to be 75, white knuckling the dashboard. He's like, Miss Harpenow, you're very comfortable behind the wheel. I was like, okay, I'm going to slow down now. My mom told me to tell you that I've never driven before. We rehearsed this in the car.
Now, see, like, this is the thing is, like, now all the rides, at least to my knowledge, they don't have any, like, manual control. It's pretty much, like, hit a button. Right.
Yeah.
I remember, like, the Freedom Train back when I was trained on it. You had, like, the throttle. You had to, like, do everything just right to get it going. And I'm glad that those days are gone, though, because
I do miss the scrambler.
Oh, my God, crank, yes.
Oh, that was fun.
That was so fun.
I never operated scrambler.
Oh, it used to have this manual crank, and you had to crank the dial up, and then it had
it always looked so powerful.
Yeah, and then it had this handbrake at the end, and I could get it to, I had to get it in a certain notch. I could get it so close that I had to use my foot and, kick it back.
Yeah. Good. Good. Operators got satisfaction from this.
I love it. But anyway, somewhere in the process, more people got involved in our training. We had Upstop Media coming in,
right,
to put cameras on the Voyage. And so we had Lori in to approve, and Sabrina and I were taking these tests.
There was a lot going on.
Yeah.
I think Alan, honestly should have reported us for harassment, Sabrina.
Probably.
During the test, because I was shouting at Alan, you didn't cover this. Yeah. He's like, yeah, I did.
It was buried underneath one of those questions you asked.
Right. Our 5,000 questions. Thunderbird was going on, was launching in the background.
We had storms rolling in.
There was
cameras being mounted.
Yes.
So it sounds like
people are running past us.
Sounds like a normal day at the park.
It really was.
Right?
Well, and it sounds like I started getting involved in the training in just the right time.
Yeah. Yes. Hollywood Nights happening in a couple hours.
The clock was counting down.
We're on Thursday right now, though, but we ended up there.
Yeah, but we started on Thursday. We ended up having to run ride cycles with Hollywood Nights on the way. But the first day of training, Sabrina and I, we had to take the test, and we're looking at each other. I'm like, this is not the best way to take a test, but we're on trash cans up against walls, trying to scrawl our answers down.
It reminds me of that scene from Men in Black whenever they're trying to take the test with those eggs.
Sabrina and I would be the people who didn't go grab the table. Adam, what point did you walk in? I'm trying to remember when you walked in.
I walked in as you guys were finishing up the last talking points of the training. And then I was there for the entire test process.
By far the best part of the whole thing.
I don't know. Running cycles
is a test process.
It was a process.
Training is an ongoing process, Matt.
Training never ends.
I don't know. I think my favorite part was all the cycles we were running, because there were a lot of witty comments coming out of Sabrina.
Leah and Sabrina got very competitive. Checking restraints.
I love going down that. I've been checking coaster restraints for over a dozen years now. So I'm just going down the train on the one side.
Yeah.
All of a sudden, Sabrina goes, "It's like I'm a go kart at a NASCAR race."
Look down, and Lori's all the way down there, and I'm competitive. We know this on the podcast. If you listened to the last episode, my blood pressure went up playing the game. Lori was Lightning McQueen. She was gone, and I'm doing my best, trying to remember which way the my hands are doing it, buckles, male and female.
Which way to do it?
I'm thinking this whole time, literally on the second car, Lori's gone. It's fine. It's okay. If I'm going to get beat by anyone, I'm cool with it being you because of your expertise.
The whole team, they're kind of pros at this.
That's true.
My favorite, though, is watching Sabrina figure out her shuffle, because I feel like everyone...
It was great.
She has her own special footwork, so you just got to get there.
Right.
When she started, I was thrown off.
I feel like everyone finds their own rhythm, though, in checking restraints.
Yep, right.
What was your advice? It's stay bent.
Don't bend. Stand up after each car. You lose your footing and your time. Yeah. You gotta kind of squat and go. You do
you gotta stay low and either take really big side steps or do a little skipping motion you're one of the monkeys from Wizard of Oz.
I've never checked restraints before. Is it helpful? Which I need to, by the way. Mm-hmm. I still want to do that.
Yes.
I wanted to be trained on a bunch of rides this summer, but then, 2020 happened.
There were other things going on.
Yeah.
Did something happen this year?
Yeah. But what I was going to ask for those of us that were in marching band, does that assist?
Yes.
Wait, was anyone here not in marching band?
Or a crab set?
I feel everyone here was a marching band person.
Right? Yeah. Wow.
Wow.
It's a good group.
We have a lot of marching band kids.
What about Josh and Steven? Were you guys marching band?
Josh.
Yeah. Josh was a drum major, and I
really? He marched really? Collegiately.
Josh, I can see it. I can see it.
Sound of my mind being blown.
I feel like Steven's about to disappoint us.
I am. I couldn't take the politics.
But you're still a musician, though.
I dropped out my senior year because politics.
But yeah. Okay. Fine. I didn't know you played drums until last week.
High school and everything.
Nice.
Very cool.
That's awesome. See, marching band, I enjoyed it, but I was an oboe player. Like, I just wanted to get back to, like, concert band so I could actually be playing my stinking instrument. I was good at
I guess you could call me marching band. I was technically color guard.
Oh, but, yeah.
You know, still, I'll go with marching band.
Still counts.
I played clarinet before that. I was just really bad at it. So I gave up the clarinet and took up the flag.
Yeah. Love it.
See, I was in percussion. I did the bass drums. Like, I just went big to little. Yep. Yeah.
Yeah.
And then I was like, well, I want to twirl a flag. That looks cool. And so I switched.
Twirl is, right?
I was what's the term of the
drumline whenever
spin.
I was in
spin.
Color
spin.
Guard.
Okay.
I was going to say, I'm like, don't, drop spin. Doesn't that like offend people, like color guard people when you say twirl?
Oh, yeah, I'm sure.
Sabrina was an athlete at heart.
I was. And that's why, like, my voyage, like, motion, we were joking. As soon as Alan said, get low, like, bend at your knees, like, something clicked in my brain, like, that athlete.
She says it's like, hustle.
I literally, like, went into, like.
The move you just did.
And that's what I like to call a link it.
Yeah. Yes. It was like, this, like, low, like, if you're, like, fielding a bunt and, like. But it, like, had a crab step in it, so, like, that band kid was in there, too. And
so you mixed your softball with your.
That should be an experience we auction off next year, get trained on the voyage or something.
They would do it. Yeah.
Restraint checks just to have a race and see who can, all these enthusiasts.
Hey, here's something we can add to Olympics.
See, I assume that was a thing. If you're not a thorough check, you're out.
What?
Like, if you're not a thorough, like, 2-hour standard check, automatically disqualified.
Gotcha.
Yeah. We've done something similar. We used to do in attractions, we would do the Amazing Attractions Hollow Race.
Yeah, oh, yeah. I remember that.
We would do, like, restraint checks at Hollow Swings.
You had to get in and get out.
Oh, my God. Revolution was great.
Merry-go-round.
Ooh,
that was one of them. We had to do restraint checks.
Yeah. That's neat.
Wow. So,
we had the glove challenge.
Well, the trick with Revolution is, since it was our safety ropes, you had to spin in circles for like 30 seconds or so. And then go in and check them.
Whoa. With the lights on.
Yes.
No thanks.
Are you sure? It's a lot of fun.
I'm good.
It's actually not as hard as you think.
All right.
So we're at restraint checks.
We made some restraint checks. I got to a point where I got to go get on console.
Nice.
I made it through that. There's a lot of changes that have happened since.
Yes.
Just a few.
So, yeah. Now you hold the button to let the train come into the station.
Mm-hmm.
Brilliant. Mm-hmm. Yep. Yes, that should be a thing.
Yep.
Yes, I did leave a train out in the blocks a couple of times. I was like, why isn't the train coming? This was like my old habits die hard.
Right.
Like, yeah.
You just live in your brain.
Yep. Well, thank you guys for training us, and thank you for being patient with us.
Bless you.
Yes.
They're like, never again.
It was fun. And
so are we still keeping your scores confidential for...
Please.
What? Are you kidding? You missed zero on the one test.
Bless you.
Yeah.
She did. I saw it. I like, as we were taking our test, we left this out that we just kept declaring...
Does your sister listen to this podcast?
She does.
Hey, Shelby.
Hey, Shlub. Let's see. It's not our birthday yet, or it's already passed, so never mind.
Happy birthday.
Unhappy birthday. But as we were like taking our test, me knowing like it was going swimmingly, and I was just like,
I see what you did there.
Yeah. Yeah. I was just like, Leah and I kept declaring, we're good at our job. We're good at what we do here.
We're not good at this.
Everybody has different skills.
That's right.
Yeah. There was a point where I had to start declaring, like, I am good at my job.
Not. We've said in the attractions office, we just have to find everyone the right seat on the bus.
Yes.
Yeah.
Nice.
We have our right seats. We were just trying to, you know, branch out a little.
That's right.
And next year we'll do a little better.
Yeah.
And,
that's right.
Yeah.
Can I study next year?
We'll give you the manual a few days in advance.
Please.
That would be great.
I wouldn't hate that. My testing anxiety just went through the roof.
Oh, I remember.
I say this like it was a month ago.
Literally a week ago, we were finishing our laps like right now.
Literally right now.
Good talk.
Oh, wow.
Right? Time flies when you're having fun.
Yeah.
Or trauma.
Yes. It's fine. Who cares? Just before we close out this episode, I wanted to do a quick run through. We are Holiday World, and we love our holidays. September 16th, because, you know, we expect to release this episode. I didn't actually get to that point yet. Today's September 4th for us. By the way, we expect to release this September 14th. September 16th. Happy birthday, Lauren. Sorry I didn't tell you about this podcast episode recording.
Winning.
September 17th is Locate an Old Friend Day, and Monte Cristo did it with Locate an Old Friend Day. It just made me think of Hollywood Nights and how everyone comes together.
I'm it's amazing. All mushy. Like the community seeing them all
feels.
Together.
Yes.
It's just so nice, though, to see, you know, kind of old friends coming together. Mm-hmm. And also, I had to leave in that Monte Cristo sandwich day because that Monte Python Monte Cristo sandwich.
Yes. It was I could eat those good. Every day.
Can they like send me more of those? Like, Matt, with, can the food and beverage Lexi. Team, like, did they make those? Did they like order those? I need to know.
Get with your girl Lexi on that one.
I need make more of those in my life.
Can we get those for Town Hall?
Yes.
Can that be a thing?
Can we get one of those Holiday World videos? Here's how you make this. Because
okay. Yes. Marking that down. What about
homemade Holiday World?
Homemade.
Caramel apples.
Those homemade ho-wo.
A win that came out
that
of this year.
That caramel apple really episode was very good.
You know, I related with you so brand. Like... I haven't bought a new candy thermometer yet. So fun fact, my grandma dropped on me. I was like, yeah, I need to clean that. She's like, yeah, your uncle brought that back for me from his deployment in Germany in 1989. And I was like, oh, my heart. So I may have pieced it back together. Because I'm a monster, but so maybe something not melted or needs a thermometer.
In case you haven't seen it, Sabrina did an amazing job with a candy thermometer making some caramel apples at home during quarantine. I love it.
Nailed it.
So, moving on. Well, September 18th is your birthday, am I correct?
It is.
And happy birthday, Sabrina.
Lori. Thanks. Lori completes our little birthday sandwich with Lauren.
Yeah, I'm right in the middle.
Oh, yes. Yeah. The 17th on Locate. An old friend that, yes.
Yeah, so it's a birthday sandwich.
Early, but only by 3 days birthday when this releases.
Nailed it.
There was a lot of detail in that description. Yeah.
You know, I'm not really a math person.
Yeah.
She's well aware.
All right. September 19th is Talk Like a Pirate Day. And Adam, I understand that you have... some stories to tell about talking like a pirate.
I think it was mentioned on a former podcast.
It probably was, but
I don't think your identity
everyone.
Was released, though. I don't think anybody knew who it was.
Oh, yeah. This is a big reveal.
Yeah, at that point, they didn't know.
So,
claim it.
Step into it.
So I think a lot of you, if you've watched that episode of the podcast, heard Paula talk about her experience with a ride operator at Mayflower and how that ride operator was using a pirate voice and how she had to politely correct that because it was a pilgrim ship, not a pirate ship. And
so Adam was given his spiel as a pirate.
Yeah, I just kind of, when you put a microphone in front of
That's
me, things
amazing.
Happen.
That sounds like something you would do.
Thank you, Matt.
I don't mean that as a compliment. Yeah.
That's how I took it.
I know I've shared this before, but Freedom Train, I had my share of bits that I would do train. I would do the proper lady of Little Miss Muffet sat on her tuffet,
nice.
Something like that. Mm-hmm. And then I would do the sportscaster. My favorite was Tom the Piper's son. Stole a pig and away he ran.
What time is this?
Freedom Train.
Okay. Yeah.
Ride ups, don't copy me.
Right.
But I was doing a bunch of pirate related jokes and voices, and you know, she leaned in very polite about it and had her very Paula-esque way of saying it.
Gentle way of kind of apologizing, but also letting you know you are very incorrect. Yes.
And make sure you knew your place in the world. Yep. Sure it was very
cool. So after that, I stopped, but I opened that attraction the very next day. And one of our assistant managers came up and said, hey, I need to talk to you about something. And I said, okay. He goes, we need to have a coaching session. I'm like, okay. About what? And all of a sudden, he just breaks out laughing, saying, I can't
believe I'm talking to you about this. But just don't do the pirate voice.
And then we need to add that a few months later we open Halloween and there's a pirate sitting in the exit. And
yes, I got very fired up about that.
Do my pirate voice.
Yes. Happy Halloween weekends come and I do the pirate voice because there's a pirate right over there.
So now if I go into your file, is there like a permanent record of this pirate voice conversation?
A flag.
I kind of hope so.
I don't think it was documented. I don't think so. Hey.
But maybe we don't do this right now.
Coachable moment. Yeah.
Sorry, my microphone was slowly sinking, so I had to adjust it.
But no, I kept talking to Lori about it after I went full time, and I asked, does Paula know that it was me? And she goes, I don't think so. So on her last...
It was her last day with the park.
I went into her office. I said, Paula, I need to tell you something. She goes, yeah. I go, I was that kid. What kid? I was the kid at Mayflower with the pirate voice. And she just starts laughing.
She didn't remember it was him. She had no idea.
Yeah. Paula, if you're listening, Liz, you know. I will forever remember these moments.
All right. September 22nd is Frida Furch's birthday. She was born in 1910. Frida was our flower lady for years and years. Mm-hmm. God bless her. She was just the best.
1910.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. She worked up until, I'm trying to remember how long she worked here, but yeah. Bless her.
That's awesome.
She was, yeah, incredible. Yeah, now I'd need to go back and look it up because we have a blog. But yeah, I think she worked until she was like 90, something like that. Like,
we've got a lot of folks that,
yeah,
that have been here a long time.
For a long mm-hmm. time.
Stick around.
I remember her. So.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. She was definitely around for a while. She may have worked till she was 100 or close to 100.
When did you start at the park, Lori? What year?
It was 2007.
So that, if you remember her, she would have been 97 then.
Yeah. So I guess, yeah.
I'm thinking it was her or Yvette, or it's the stories of her because.
Yeah.
I think
at a certain point she would come in just like once in a while.
And that might be what it is.
But yeah, she, yeah. Wow. Talk about a person who, you know, gave her life to the park. Amazing. On a totally unrelated note, September 22nd is also Doodle Day, which just makes me think of the fact that Sabrina just came into my office for the last podcast episode so she could get pictures of all the doodles that I do. I really went pro this shutdown this year in doodling while taking notes. It's like a thing I do just to stay focused on things. Like my hand has to do something, so I start doodling, and yeah, they really took off. Let me see.
As a side note, Frida, yes. The blog post says, yes, that Frida worked from 1954 until 2009.
Oh my gosh.
Wow. So I do remember seeing
yes.
That. Yeah.
Says she worked the front gate, helping in the kitchen. She sewed a red suit for Santa Claus one time.
Wait, when did she start?
1954.
Wow.
So she
2009. So she worked until she was 98 or 99 years old?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Wow. That is impressive.
Yeah.
Yep.
And meanwhile, I plan to retire at a nice young age.
And there's a shout out to her, the Thunderbird downstairs
yes.
too. On
yes.
The side.
Yes.
Is there?
Yeah. There yeah. is.
What is it?
It's like a flower. It's a sign about
it's
flowers.
It's like a flower ad or something like that. We tried to pay tribute and pay homage to all of our longtime employees.
Mm-hmm. She's here.
That's the same reason that our Thunderbird shop is named Hevron's Mercantile. Is Joe Hevron was a long time employee. I think he left for like 2 years of his life to go to war. Yeah, and came back and worked at Holiday World for the rest of his life.
It's an acceptable reason.
Yeah, yeah. I found that pretty acceptable.
Wow. But
yeah, Joe worked in cash control, and he was my boss for a while.
And how old was Joe when he left the park?
I want to say like 90.
Wow.
But he began his career here in 1946. Sorry, I'm like...
You're doing great with this fact drive.
Stuff. Is this on our website?
It is.
Okay.
Like, mental note, don't play trivia with Sabrina. She'll right. be...
Yeah. Hey, Sabrina, you want to play trivia against Lori?
We're going to 3-2, aren't we?
It's not me. It's our magnificent Hala blog where you can find on our website. So,
I think you just mixed up our department with marketing, Sabrina.
Sorry. Flashbacks from my previous life. So, it's Frida was here for 55 years, and he worked at the park for 65 years.
Yeah.
Wow.
He was born in 1929.
Mm-hmm.
So, pretty incredible. He was 81 when he passed. So.
Oh, okay. I had that completely wrong. But, yeah.
Yeah, but still.
Joe was my favorite boss by far.
No.
Just the sweetest. Not sure how to transition from like the best people that have ever worked for us into September 23rd is the autumnal equinox.
I was wondering how you're going to say that. That's what I was waiting for. I'm like, she'll know how to pronounce it.
I considered skipping it, but...
you should have just had Matt try to read it.
Without Sabrina and I have been getting into... autumnal.
Autumnal equinox.
Honestly, it's just the start of fall. Let's be real.
Yeah.
But just with how, you know, Sabrina and I have been getting really into like the moon phases now because of social media.
We acknowledge.
The full moon, things go wild.
Yeah.
It's weird. It's bizarre.
Yeah.
Even like, what was it? 2 days ago was a full moon?
Wednesday. Yeah, Wednesday.
Wednesday was a full moon.
It was a corn moon because it's a corn moon because it signifies like the beginning of harvest.
Oh.
So that's why they call it a corn moon.
Yeah, I've been very confused. I've been like going through on like the moon and all that stuff.
You have to acknowledge how everyone at the
this
table
time she
not,
didn't have to Google.
And it really is. Yeah. I wish it was a farmer and they started chilling corn this week.
Yeah.
So
I wish anyone listening to this would have just looked at all of our faces staring at Sabrina.
Useless knowledge.
Yes.
It's not useless.
Everyone but Leah leans in, concerned and intrigued.
I'm like, yep, that's standard Sabrina. That's what I've come to expect.
it comes with a package.
You're welcome. Just with how Sabrina and I are now obsessed with the moon. You know, just had to share it that, you know, the Earth's rotation is changing and autumn is coming, and let's hope for next year. Just fingers crossed for a much better year. September 25th, we did a QVC live broadcast from the park back in 1999, and boy, I was there.
That's amazing.
Oh, yeah.
What were you doing?
Playing with Betty Spaghetti dolls.
Do you have this on tape?
Probably somewhere. I don't know. I'm looking at Steven.
I've got to see this.
And what was it? What are they called? Big blocks or better blocks or whatever. Those like oval shaped like Lego things.
Yeah.
That you can curve around and stuff. Oh, yeah. We were just like toy models. And it was.
Alan, are you just as confused as I am? Okay.
See, you had me a Betty Spaghetti.
Where was the broadcast filmed at?
Holiday Theater, obviously back before it was the walkthrough attraction.
Yeah.
But yeah, it was all Christmassy, Christmased out. And yeah, they did a live broadcast.
That's
I got
cool.
to be
wow.
a
Can we do
child
that again?
Featured on that.
I'm
looking
QVC.
At these blocks now.
Betty Spaghetti was my jam, though.
Betty Spaghetti
that was
cool.
Awesome.
We bought a Betty Spaghetti.
They're like, okay, so the guys...
Betty Spaghetti.
Is that one of those off-brand dolls?
They knock off.
That's the great value brand.
That's funny.
Gotta change your first name.
Can someone invent Betty Buschetti? Okay, better blocks. Yes, it's a thing.
Did they also come out with the best blocks?
Those
were so like, you could like make a crown. The kids in the commercials always had like a crown on because you could bend it in a circle.
Huh.
So it was like,
you're too young, Adam. You wouldn't understand.
When she's right, she's right.
I mean, yeah.
There are some things that you can make with better blocks. I show on my phone and not for listeners at all.
Yes, we'll put like a note.
Just
to...
Google it, guys, and we'll add some weird pictures to the blog.
I remember those on like the As Seen on TV stuff.
Yeah,
like and they
it
just
was on TV. Yeah. I was
QVC.
Playing with it.
I know. Jealous. So
anyway,
jealous.
Weirder memories of my life.
Totally normal.
Back in 1999, 9-year-old Leah just playing with Betty Spaghetti. Betty Buschetti.
Betty. We get that in the merch shop next year. Betty Spaghetti with like made to thrill shirts options.
Yes.
I'd buy two of those, maybe three, so I wouldn't have to share with my children.
Amazing. September 25th is also binge day. So, you know, if you haven't listened to the Holiday World podcast or if this is your first episode, it's a good day to go back and binge a bunch of old episodes, you know. We're getting close to our 100th episode, if you include, quote-unquote, season one.
Yeah.
We were up to 70-something episodes, so soon we'll get there. September 26th is Save Your Photos Day. Guys, how do you guys save your photos? Do you have cloud? What do you do? I'm like, I don't understand.
They're just there.
Is this like an old thing, like an outdated like thing for Save Your Photos? Because like the cloud, I feel like now.
This is probably going to sound very ignorant, but whenever I read Save Your Photos Day, I just thought, what else are you going to do with your photos?
Forgotten, it's another holiday called like delete useless and bad photos day.
Clean out your screenshots.
Dude, I need that.
Yeah. Accidental screenshots. I don't know how many times I have accidentally screenshotted my wallpaper on my phone.
It happens.
I just like randomly go through like my old photos. And I'm like 10:23 a.m. What? Like, was there something? I'm like looking at the notifications. Like, was there some significance to this? No, it was just an accidental screenshot. And finally, September 27th is Tourism Day. And, you know, I just think it's a good day to give everyone in the tourism industry a socially distanced hug. I don't really know, but send them a note of appreciation because it's been a rough year for the tourism industry. So send everyone your love on September 27th. Mm-hmm. Congratulations. You voyaged your way to the end of another episode. Please join us in some number of weeks. Oh, that's 2 weeks. Sorry. This is an old outro. Nailing it. Please join us in 2 weeks during your next commute, cleaning session, etc. for our next episode, season 2, episode 21, the one with two nights feedback. Thank you to all of our behind the scenes pod squad, Steven, drum major Josh, and Sabrina, the champion of the training test.
Steven, you didn't get any extra words, but we still love you.
Yes, Steven. Thanks for being the master charade person today. Yes. And thanks to all of you for listening and being patient with us. Please subscribe and leave a review on iTunes, Spotify, Google Podcasts, YouTube, Facebook, etc. And tell all your friends. On behalf of today's pod squad, Missing Matt Eckert and Mama Lauren, as well as the new semi-regular pinch hitters, Matt B. and Sabrina, and also myself, thank you. Please be sure to share your feedback and questions with us by calling us at 812-937-4401, then dial 8081, or by emailing us at podcast@holidayworld.com, or by reaching out to us on social media using the hashtag
#HoHoPo.
You've been listening to the official Holiday World Podcast.
Welcome back. Did you enjoy your flight?
A production of Holiday World and Splash and Safari in Santa Claus, Indiana. Check out the latest episodes at holidayworld.com/podcast. Thanks for taking a ride with us.
And please come back to see us again soon.
Holiday World and Splash and Safari introduces Cheetah Chase, the world's first launched water coaster.
Launched water coaster? Can you even do that? Is that even a thing?
Oh, they made it a thing. Full speed right off the bat, racing side by side. Yeah, Cheetah Chase is a thing.
And the only place to find tickets this summer and experience this whole Cheetah Chase thing for yourself is HolidayWorld.com. Oh, one more thing.